They clear our plates, clean our floors, sell tissue paper. As health problems and medical costs mount for older Singaporeans, a number will find that they don't have enough Medisave, or that insurance premiums are too high. What are Singaporeans ready to do to give seniors more peace of mind? Would you pay higher MediShield premiums so that they get better coverage? Is Singapore today a place that you would want to grow old in? Tell us what you think.
Good evening. Welcome to Voices Today. I'm Nicholas Fang, and that was Derek Paolo, the editor of Voices at the Today newspaper, introducing tonight's topic: what kind of Singapore do you want to grow old in? And I'm not looking pointedly at my co-hosts in any way.
Which, by the way, Nick, good evening. I'm Will Xavier. There's only one rule today, and it is this: no one is calling anybody uncle.
I got that.
Or else it's a dollar in this cup.
Awesome. Well, we want to hear from you tonight, whether you are young, middle-aged, or in your golden years. So call us if you want to share your views on air. That's at 669-11020. Or you can tweet us with the hashtag VoicesToday, or leave your comments at tdy.sg/VoicesToday.
I wonder why he's looking at me every time he says golden years. We welcome some of our callers tonight with us on Google Hangout. They are Geraldine Pierre. She's 22, a communications undergraduate who runs a social enterprise. She's going to tell us more about that in a moment. Gerard E, who chairs the Council for Third Age, a familiar face, of course. Dr. Goh Lee Gan, president of the Gerontological Society of Singapore. Also, Dr. Kalyani Mehta, head of the gerontology program at SIM University, SIM. And Carol Lim. Hi, Carol. She is in human resource and a community volunteer. Let me throw open to all of you a question we've been asking Today readers all this week. Do you think now is a place where Singapore now is where one can grow old with dignity? And by way of definition, Kalyani, help us out with this. Is Singapore a place where one can grow old with dignity?
I think it is a place where we can grow old with dignity, but I think we have a lot of room for improvement. For example, the cost of living is just shooting very high, and it's going to hit the seniors as well as their caregivers. And of course, noise pollution has been increasing with a lot of cars on the road. But on the other hand, it's the place we call home. And it's the place where one would like to spend the golden years.
Okay, let's move on to Lee Gan. Now, Lee Gan, at the Gerontological Society of Singapore, you look at these sort of issues. Is Singapore a place where the elderly can grow old with this sense of dignity and grace?
I would say by and large, yes. I suppose the thing about all is that all the different reasons are looked upon as equal, so there is discrimination. As far as progress is concerned, I think Singapore is not bad in the sense that we have gone through a relatively affluent kind of progress. So I would say that by and large, it is a good place to stay in. Okay.
Good place to stay in. What about that, Geraldine?
Of the ways I feel that Singapore has been unfriendly for senior citizens is actually the language policy. The policy to not allow dialects on local television and radio has actually resulted in a lot of elderly being isolated. They have no access to news because they do not understand certain happenings that are happening in our country. For instance, during the haze, many of them were not able to understand the public service announcements, and they were unfamiliar about certain things like how surgical masks differ from the N95 masks, and what is PM2.5, and what is PSI.
Okay, I think we have established that there are certain issues that need to be looked at, obviously, but Singapore certainly can't be called lax in targeting support measures for senior citizens, and that's no surprise given how quickly our population is aging. I think to quickly go through just some of the measures that are out there, we've got purpose-built HDB studio flats for the elderly, we've got re-employment laws to protect older workers, MediShield coverage recently extended to the age of 90, and also the maintenance of Parents Act, and more than 100 care facilities are going to be built over the next 5 years. And of course, organizations like the Council for Third Age promoting active aging.
So why is it, judging by the comments and letters we've received this week, there is such pessimism about the prospect of growing old in Singapore? The bulk of the worries seem to be about the cost of living. You're a numbers person. Gerard, help us out with this.
Well, I think it's a matter of expectations of the individuals and maintenance of a social contract. For most older persons, the big bulk of their savings is in the property that they have worked very hard to buy. So unless they can encash it, or if they want to hand over to a child, there's a social contract that the child will look after them, give them pocket money and so forth. So today, even the issue of children giving parents some pocket money has become quite contentious.
Okay. Carol, what about your thoughts about on that issue?
I think most parents who are my generation, basically we have CPF. We have worked for most of our life. And I don't see any issue. It's basically how you bring up your child and what goes around comes around.
Yeah. We got a call earlier this week, or rather we heard from Today reader Chang Mei Lian. And quoting here, I am from the working middle class, talking about the rising cost of living, perennial question. I started my family late, she says. I have elderly parents to support and a 30-year HDB loan to pay. I worry about my children and their future. I worry about my health and the rising medical costs and whether my income can keep up by someone's 50th birthday. If you lose your job, it'll be hard to find a job of equal pay. I need this job. I can't afford to be jobless. That must be the complaint of many people, no?
I believe so.
Yes, go on, please.
Now, I think even from before, different families have different issues, and some families, even when I was a child, I've heard of them struggling to make ends meet. So there will always be such issue, even 20, 30, 50 years from now. So, and they need help.
I think the other issue is when the adult children migrate and they live in other countries. So I think there will be couples who are aging who have to fend for themselves. And that's when they need a lot of community-based services to help them out. Just like in Switzerland or in the Scandinavian countries.
Okay, but besides community-based services, what about the idea of social safety nets? Do you think we could do with more of that in Singapore?
Certainly. I think we could do with a lot more of calibrated kind of social safety nets so that we target the right people.
Okay, some examples of that perhaps.
For example, you may have elderly parents who are childless. Then you may have elderly parents who have strained with their relationships with adult children. Sometimes a divorcee may be all alone because the support networks have broken down. I think we have to look at this issue as a very complicated issue.
Sure. I think that worth noting that the more social safety nets we provide, the greater the tax burden on possibly the next generation or even the younger taxpayers. What are the thoughts about that?
Anyone? Think this is a kind of a leverage that has been used again and again. Maybe it is true, but I think currently many Singaporeans feel that it should not be the reason why changes are not made.
Okay, well that's a good point. But what about Geraldine, as a younger Singaporean yourself? What about that idea to you?
I think we have to be understanding about the issue of aging population. Like, we really need to pay a slightly more taxes to support the elderly. We should be more like understanding and make compromises.
Okay. Mm. Well, let's move on to another
issue. It's a huge worry for older Singaporeans. We hear endlessly about medical bills and growing ones. And I'm hard-pressed to use the word burden here. But whether younger Singaporeans might be willing to step up to help lighten the load, as it were.
Yeah, I think that one of the points was that to enhance health insurance coverage for older Singaporeans, including extending that coverage up to the age of 90. In March this year, MediShield and private integrated plan premiums were increased, but this has actually provoked some unhappiness, especially among retirees with no current source of income. How do you guys on Google Hangout respond to those kind of concerns? Gerard, perhaps we could tap on you.
No, I mean, certainly for retirees who have no income, any increase in expenses is always something that becomes an additional burden. But I think the real issue, we do have a lot of safety nets, a lot of schemes going on to help individuals. But no matter what we do, the real issue with seniors who are suffering is isolation. And that's something that we don't seem to have an answer towards it. And if you look at seniors who have deteriorated or even deciding to end their life, it's always got to do with isolation where they feel that society no longer care about them. So okay. Social impact studies have been done elsewhere where programs have been done to help older people. And they found that it is really the human interaction that is the most important.
No, Gerard, hold that thought. We're definitely going to come back to that in the next segment. But let's try to get some thought on this. Are younger Singaporeans willing to help lighten the burden of the older Singaporeans? We have a poll of 50 young working adults, and 3 in 4 said they were willing to pay more so that the elderly pay less. And this was done by Today. And most said that they will pay up to 30% more in MediShield premiums. What do you guys think of this, really quickly?
I think it's great. I think it's a very good sign that we have altruism among both the young and the old.
I think I would like to stress one point. There are those who have arrived who are today the elderly. And as we introduce such schemes, I hope that the younger people realize that they have to prepare for the time when they become an elderly and start saving now while they're young and have the income.
We're going to talk about ageism and attitudes in just a moment. Right now, time for a break. When we come back, we talk about whether Singaporeans are basically ageist. Join us in just a moment.
We were talking a little bit earlier in the show about the issue of costs that the elderly in Singapore are facing. And of course, for that, healthcare makes up a certain proportion, a major proportion. Mm-hmm. We've got a caller on the line, Victor, who has some innovative ideas or an idea on how to deal with healthcare costs and lessening that burden for the elderly. Victor, share your thoughts with us.
Yeah, okay. First, to increase the GST a few percentage points, then lock in the increase for National Medical Scheme, whereby every Singaporean in PR will get free medical care. And it's up to the government to decide what medical class patients be admitted to.
But how do you think that the rest of Singapore would actually respond to that idea?
Well, I do not know, but the thought of getting free medical care when they're old, that's like it then.
I think so. I think that might be a possibility, especially with our aging population. Thanks very much for those ideas.
So, are society's ageist attitudes at the root of challenges facing older Singaporeans? Some interesting news this week. From today, all low-wage public officers who are re-employed will retain the same job grade and pay as they had before. But before all this, they had to take pay cuts when they were re-employed. The public service was seen to actually lag practices in the private sector.
Yeah, and it's been said that ageism or stereotyping of the elderly is actually practiced by both society and policymakers. And seniors are seen more as a burden, as less productive economic units, as a result of the very result-oriented mindset that's been drilled into our culture. We have a reader from Today who's written that in a country that celebrates youth and efficiency, the fear of growing old is tremendously stressful. In fact, we have Elaine on the line. Elaine, would you like to elaborate on your concern?
Hi. I think because we view people for their functionality, I think sometimes we lose the innate value of who they really are. and we see them for what they can do. And that becomes almost more important than who they really are.
Okay. Well, how does this actually translate into how we treat the elderly?
Okay, so a few ideas that I've been thinking about. Because as they grow old, physically they're not so capable to do certain things. And their roles will start to change, and they may not have a main say in some of the decisions in their family. On top of that, the ability of work or, you know, what previously they used to do would decrease. And I think when some of these things change and then roles are modified, maybe they feel a sense of loss, a sense of adjustment. Yeah. That it's a bit hard to cope. And because we change so quickly, I think the older people find it harder to cope.
Yeah.
And when they do, we naturally just drop them faster than, you know. Yeah.
Got it. Thank you, Elaine. Google callers, Hangout callers, the word burden seems to be slightly troublesome, don't you think?
Yeah. Well, I think the caller example is very much personal to the individual, how he or she copes with aging itself. So I think a lot more needs to be done to help us to understand, especially in this field of gerontology that Meta is in, help us to understand and they have developed strategies to grow old well. So there are many aspects of it. I think Meta can really expand on it. You know, you have your mental, you have a social aspect. It is not a single dimension.
Even
the better prepared we are, the better.
Even the spiritual aspect, Jack.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Correct. Add in. Well, I think the important thing is actually to get the older people to understand their health better. This thing called health literacy. This afternoon, we have one patient in the polyclinic. He has got a low hemoglobin, and we think that he could be having some cause of bleeding, maybe cancer in the large colon, for instance. And we spent about 30 minutes trying to persuade him that he should go for investigation, and he stubbornly said no. And we said that, look, can we speak to your children? And he said no, I'm okay. So I see that at the back of many things, teaching people what is normal health, what is the early signs of poor health, is just as important. So that's the first point. The second point is also to teach our older people how to take care of themselves better. For example, this diet, exercise, and weight control.
Yeah.
Okay, so...
Fortunately,
go on.
Fortunately, if you look at the older folks, and compare that with our younger generation of Singaporeans,
yeah,
I think the older folks are actually much healthier. So there is something that the older people could teach our younger generation that, look, exercise, diet, reduction is still very important.
Right. Mm. You think that's changing, though, in terms of the way they are viewed, Carol? You work in human resource. What are the younger folks are thinking about all of this in as much as from the outside looking in, or younger people looking at how older people interact with them or their part, a place in society?
And in the workplace as
In the workplace, especially.
I think... we are viewed as slow, and we don't deserve to earn the same salary that we deserve. You know, especially when you're applying for a job, when you know they ask you and you are of the age, the conversation stops there, which I think is not fair.
Mm.
And elderly has got experience, and mind you, in my working place, I'm the one who doesn't take sick leave. It's the younger generation who takes more sick leave.
Mm.
And we are not compensated for, you know, what our worth. Some of us, it depends on the industry that you're working in. You could be, you know, doing like finance and admin, and your physical abilities does not affect your thinking and you're doing the job. Therefore, why should your salary be lowered?
Mm.
Mm. Okay.
So I think we need, first of all, the public sector to take the lead.
Right.
Secondly, we need to have enlightened employers.
employers who should remember that they themselves one day will be old, and how would they like to be viewed?
Okay, I think we've got, Geraldine, we wanted to come to you now, and we're talking about bridging this gap between generations, between perspectives, and how the different generations view each other. Do you have any thoughts on that?
I would say that I would feel that the younger people actually do care about the elderly. However, there's actually this language barrier due to the dialects issue that I was mentioning earlier. Mm. A lot of young people cannot speak dialects, and therefore they cannot communicate with the elderly. I've seen a lot of such instances when a lot of us youths go to old folks' home and help out, and many of us are unable to communicate with the elderly, and we need translators. Like I help my friends to translate because I speak Hokkien at home, and but it's still not sufficient. Yeah.
So are we talking mainly of the Chinese community?
Well, I think it's very lah.
I think we have to look at age group.
Yes. Yeah.
Gerard, please go on.
I think you have to look at age group. You have the elderly who are in their 80s or late 70s to the 80s that would fall into this category that Geraldine is speaking of. And then you have the new elderly that are arriving who are in the mid. So for each cohort has a very different experience. And very soon, the new old like myself, who is 65 this year, for us, language is not the issue.
Gerard. I think a lot of the discussion that we've had so far points to the question of what would actually make Singapore a place where one can grow old with dignity, where one would be happy to grow old in. You know.
Yeah.
Earlier in the show, we were talking about combating issues of loneliness and making the elderly feel a more welcome part of society. Senior activity centres help to do just that. Let's hear from 76-year-old Chai Chi resident, Madam Teo Yim Ti.
Glad to hear it. We also spoke about seniors who are volunteering their time to help other seniors lead meaningful lives. We're going to meet IT trainer Sam Liu now, 76, and has been volunteering for more than 15 years.
I picked up IT many years ago. I learned it just by passion-wise. I work with some big corporate conglomerate in the United States on satellite launch. And since then, I've been quite active on a social caseworker. I teach a lot of ITs for seniors. You have people who are ex-lawyers, ex-doctors. They retire many years ago. They forgot what's all about. But they also did not realize technology moves so fast. The government realized it, that it is a waste for those retirees to lying idle at home. Often the seniors have told us that, is it difficult? So I told them, of course it's difficult, because you don't know. And nobody was born and learned how to do computers or other matters. You have to learn. And learning is not easy, but it can be done. Lonely is not very well defined locally, because a person who's staying at home can have the whole family with them, but they still feel lonely. I do a lot of home visiting together with medical people, but at least we can talk to them and counsel them. I also work very actively in a lot of hospitals as the interpreter. Imagine those seniors giving back full of medicine And the poor pharmacist trying to explain what to take after this, they don't understand. I volunteered also with the NUS to coming up with the medicine dispenser thing. All you need to do is to load it up and press the button. In US, you greet anybody, they'll smile, return a smile. But in Hong Kong, you greet them, they say, you're mad, I don't even know you. So this is what is happening in Singapore. The government started a lot of national games and also the cultural shows at the Padang. It's just bonding to bring busload of seniors to the place and they interact very well.
When they invented the word can do, they were talking about this guy here. Close to one in five elderly Singaporeans over 75 feel sad or lonely, signs of depression, and you wonder whether that's a medical condition. A survey in recent years has been showing that. And the suicide rate, by the way, among those aged 65 and above is 24 in every 100,000, twice of that for younger people here.
Yeah, and to underline that sense of isolation of a small group of elderly citizens, every now and again you read or hear about someone living alone who dies and his body is only found days later. What does this actually say of our society as a whole? Where are we actually failing the elderly? Let's turn to our Google Hangout callers and get a sense of that. What do you guys think about that?
I think socially we could do more with elderly coming out and interacting more because the young generation have to go to work. So it is important that we encourage the seniors to come out rather than stay in the home all alone. But it cannot be done that easily. So they need a little bit of coaxing, perhaps by volunteers and befrienders. But I think with the baby boomer generation, like Gerard was saying earlier, I think they are just raring to go. They have so much to give to society. It's just how to match their skills with the need of society.
I think if you have daycare center that's located near a few blocks of flat within close proximity, they could be encouraged to go down to mingle, to mix with other people, because then it becomes a routine rather than, you know, individually going, trying to find your friends. At the center itself, you can do some networking, get to know others, you know, and even caregiver can bring the persons that they are looking after there to interact with others.
I think the major, the crux of the issue is we need to look out for each other and try to regain some of the old kampong spirit. What happens today is we treasure our privacy so much. And while we do good works, people in the East goes all the way to the West to run a program for the elderly, and then not knowing that the neighbor is suffering. If every one of us just look out for our neighbor, then everybody will be cared for.
Yeah, the alarming suicide rate, in fact, had everything to do with the sense of neighborliness or the lack thereof.
Yes.
Thank you, Gerard. I want to bring Diana Kwok into the conversation. Diana, you had a point to make about care facilities. Are you joining us by telephone, Diana?
Right. Yes, okay. Now, actually, what happened is this, okay? My mom has been on the wheelchair bound since 2006, all right? And what happened is that when she, I have to employ a helper, all right, to look after her, see, all right? And for the... I feel that, you know, the government should allow us to actually use our MediSave to pay for the subsidies to employ a helper, you see. All right? Okay, that's one thing. And the other thing is that for my mom, whenever my helper has to go back for a home leave, I have to look for a place for her to... place her for respite care, you see, all right? And there are not many nursing homes in Singapore that can offer respite care for about 1 month, okay? And for that 1 month, I have to pay up to about $3,000 up front and then a deposit of another $3,000 in order to get her into the facility, okay? And all these things, you know, I mean, if the government can provide some form of a subsidies, if not, then at least we can use our MediSave, okay, to pay for it, you see. Yeah. That would be of great help because I'm the sole breadwinner in the family.
Right.
You know?
No, this this idea of nursing home in the heartlands is a very interesting one. And I think the notion that this idea that people talk about in the past, the Singaporeans should...
It's difficult to get a place to put my mom for respite care, you know.
Mm.
And even if you have to put her on respite care, you know, the cost is quite prohibitive,
sure.
You know.
Okay,
yes.
Thanks, Diana.
Yeah, thank you, Diana.
This idea, as I was talking about earlier, the notion that Singaporeans should look to JB, nursing homes for affordable elderly care, that's actually been a very controversial one in Singapore.
Mm, mm.
But now the Singapore government is actually directly investing in building 10 new nursing homes by 2016 instead of leaving it to the market. And now it can select operators who actually offer quality care at lower prices. The problem now, residents are complaining that they don't want nursing homes or elder care centres or studio flats near their blocks.
Yeah.
It's the not in my backyard syndrome all over again.
Yeah, Google Hangout, what did you make of the not in my backyard or the NIMBY attitude that seems to have reared its ugly head?
I think reality hasn't struck them because they would be elderly in years to come. And obviously, if the centres is near homes, it's easier for, you know, the families to visit the elderly who is in the home itself.
Yeah, is this lack of neighbourliness that we have to go back to core values.
Mm.
And I think the problem with it is rapid progress. We have ignored these core values, principles, and a lot of people have very warped value about life. And they're just not really caring enough.
I have another point that I want to add, is that the whole concept of nursing homes, nursing homes in other countries are now being built like group homes, where they are small entities where you may have about 15 or maybe 16 elderly in one apartment. In that way, it is not like a sore thumb sticking out in any community. They would be there with the community and very well connected with the community.
Mm. But Kalani, I want to, just an interesting concept, but how does this grouping of the elderly together avoid this idea of creating senior enclaves and creating, you know, sort of segmenting them in themselves? You mentioned they will actually be more connected. How does that work?
You see, currently, our nursing homes are very hospital-like. There are dormitories for men, dormitories for women. I was talking to an operator recently. Even the husband and wife cannot meet without the permission of the person in charge. And that too, only for a short period of time. Actually, our concept of institutions has to evolve. If they are small entities, I think the whole idea of a stigma to a nursing home will dissolve because these smaller group homes will be more like extended relatives living together.
Yeah.
Okay.
Beyond extended relatives, it'd be nice to view them as being responsible contributors to society and the economy as well. Usefulness, right?
So.
We have Helen Lim, who's the founder of Silver Spring, which helps seniors re-enter the job market. How are you doing, Helen?
Fine. I'm being very busy trying to job match seniors back to work,
mm-hmm.
the silver talents.
How is that working out?
I think it is. 2013 is really a turning point. I think there are many more opportunities now.
Give us an idea of the sort of thing you are able to match or difficulties with not being able to match.
I think it is really about matching people who are, first of all, the seniors need to be more flexible, more open-minded about the kind of jobs, not exactly the same as they had in the past, but big interest. And secondly, it's about potential employers also willing to embrace a few more seniors coming in to contribute.
Right. A bigger problem on the demand or the supply side, people not wanting the jobs being offered or people asking for jobs that your clients are unable to fulfill?
I would say until now, it would be more the the stereotyping of seniors as old-fashioned, stubborn, fixed in their ideas, slower to learn. So it was more of an age bias, anyone above 45. Yeah, but today I think with more awareness now and more knowing that there are many silver talents willing to come down in terms of the kind of jobs they are looking for, and also being seen as more energetic, I think there's a lot more positive signs now.
Okay, so it's more looking at it from the point of view of the elderly themselves, changing their own attitudes about how they can contribute and how they can be part of society. Let's maybe go to Google Hangout and speak to Geraldine. We spoke a little bit earlier about the attitudes of the young towards the elderly. Now we're talking about the elderly's own attitudes about themselves. So how do you think that can be improved?
I think we need a bit more encouragement. For my personal experience with the elderly, I find them to be quite pessimistic about themselves. Like, they always have the mentality like, oh, I'm going to die soon, that kind of thing. There's no point learning new things or experiencing more in life. So I try to give them, like the elderly in my neighborhood, which are my grandparents' friends, like some encouragement on how they can, like they can contribute to society. They can still work. They can still learn new things even though they are old. And try to instill this whole idea of active aging into them. Yeah.
I would like to add on what Geraldine just said. Actually, when people have to be wheelchair bound, there is still so much potential that they can contribute.
Yes, go on.
So I think we, as members of public, tend to correlate physical handicap with mental shortcomings, which is not the truth. You can see so many examples of people who are wheelchair bound, but they can still do so many things that are IT related, or even counseling and other ways by which they still continue to use their talent.
Right.
So when I go to nursing homes especially, I think there's so much more opportunity to do education with people with mobility.
Sure. That's a good point.
Speaking of mobility, we have Dr. Noel Chia. Dr. Noel Chia, right? Who joins us now and talks about the physical landscape. Are the disabled, perhaps the elderly, finding it a big problem getting around?
There are two groups of people that we are looking at here. One is the disabled elderly. The other group is elderly disabled. So it's how we look at them, right? So there's two groups, right? Disabled elderly and elderly disabled. They're two different groups.
Okay, how are they different?
Yeah. Now for the disabled elderly, now these are the older citizen or senior who over time, because of their age and their old age-related problems, such as failing eyesight, hard of hearing, dementia, and therefore becomes an issue.
Mm-hmm.
The other group, which is the elderly disabled, which is all along they've been disabled. Now, they might be those with very severe autism, perhaps with some other ailments, and they are the ones who probably do not even have a job most of the time.
But you were saying that the physical infrastructure in Singapore now is not helpful for them.
I think for the other one is basically physically disabled, as the one of the person said for physically disabled, they still can perform. It's not a problem. They don't have mental challenges there. But then there are others who are basically have mental challenges, where they are probably more intellectually disabled than those on the wheelchair with no mental challenges.
Yeah, you're saying that it just goes beyond the physical environment. Is it not clear that with the impending silver tsunami, that while you can make any number of improvements to the onset of old age issues, what can we do about the mental state of these folks?
Yes, I think the government is trying to improve in terms of the fiscal structure, and maybe in terms of the building, the gadget services, what we term it as the universal design. provide in terms of facilities provided for them, so that we hope that with this universally designed gadget or technologies or architecture or building, will help them to be able to mingle like anyone else, you know, like any other normal people.
Okay, let's go back to our hangout callers. This idea of physical infrastructure. Anybody have any thoughts about whether we're well geared up, not so well geared up, need more work?
No, I think it will always be work in progress. It is a process of evolving it. Like today, public transport, there are lifts for everybody who is to get access to the trains and so forth. But I think the last caller make it very, very clear that there is the other aspect of it, which I think the strategy must be one of lifelong learning. That means we must never stop learning and keep our mind alert and plug into the changes that's happening around us. So if you look at these panelists, when we become really the elderly, we're already on Google Hangout. So we are quite up to date. So we won't be outdated so easily, you know.
Okay. Well, we're almost out of time. So, Gerard, since we have you on, we'll go to everyone as well. But could you just very quickly sum up, what do you think would be the ideal Singapore for one to grow old in? Really quickly.
Options. There must be as many options as possible. No two seniors are the same. And when I am really the senior at 70 and 80, which is not so far away, I'd like to have an option. At that point in time, I will decide whether I want to live with the family, or I want to go to a nursing home or a retirement home. But I like to see that there are options available.
Yeah. Carol?
I think that there shouldn't be any senior who has nowhere to go or, you know, someone to take care of them. And at least the society will be there to look after them.
What does Geraldine think?
I agree, Carol. I think we should have a more caring society, a one where people are considerate, willing to put the needs of the elderly ahead of them. Mm. And there should be platforms for the elderly to receive mental and emotional kind of fulfillment. Yeah.
Yeah. What does the future look like, Kalyani, and how far away?
I am a very realistic person. I feel that there are a lot of improvements required still in Singapore, but I think the most important is to respect our elderly, because they have contributed so much to where Singapore is today, and we should never forget their sacrifices that help Singapore reach where it is today.
Okay. Maybe just to expand a little bit on that last part, this idea of respect for your elderly, what is lacking? You know, what needs to be done to engender this idea of respect for the elderly? Is it more promotional, more awareness about what the elderly can actually do within the society? We have Helen still on the line. Maybe you could share some thoughts about that.
Oh, yes. I think besides awareness, people should begin even to take small steps of actions and behaviors to be more inclusive at the workplace, especially, I think quite a lot perhaps are being done in the family, but at the workplace, to have more inclusiveness and embracing at all ages. But rather than, you know, kind of begin to put people aside just because you have grown older, but the inclusiveness, bring it from awareness level to actions, even small action. I think by seeing one active ager contributing, more will change their mindset. So rather than talking, I think make many, many more companies take action.
Right. Thank you very much indeed. It does seem as if that the elderly have the wherewithal to have an attitude that will overcome their circumstances. And they've been around a while, so I think they've got this one figured out.
I think so. And, well, it's a shame, but we have to bring tonight's lively discussion to a close. But do keep thinking and, more importantly, talking to us about the important issues. And if there's a topic that you actually like to see us tackle on the show, go to tdy.sg/voicestoday and you can leave your ideas there or email us at voices@mediacorp.com.sg. See you next Thursday at 9 p.m. the live telecast of Voices Today.